Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Healing Waters broadcast. This is Dr. Jeremy Mays, and I hope you're doing well this week. Over the last couple of weeks, it's been awesome to hear from some of you that have been watching the broadcast and been encouraged and just felt the presence of the Lord. I can honestly say for Nikki and I that one of our favorite things about ministry, yes, we love to preach, love to teach and all that, and we love our relationship with God more than anything else. But one of our favorite things about ministry is being able to connect with people. We love going to different churches and ministering and seeing what the Lord is doing in different parts of the country. And even as a kid, when my parents were evangelists, we'd go to those churches that maybe we had been to before and I was kind of familiar with the folks. And I loved being able to go back and see those old friends again. With that being said, I love connecting with you guys through this TV broadcast. And if you want to connect with us, you can send us a prayer request either on our Facebook page, Dr. Jeremy Mays and Family, or you can email us at mays@gmail.com. We'd love to just hear from you, but more than that, we'd love to meet you sometime. Preaching on TV is great, but it's a little hard to shake hands with you or lay hands on you through a camera. So when you find out that we're coming to your area, if you'd come be in service with us, let's have a great time in the Lord together. With that said, March the 19th at 10:45 a.m., we'll be preaching at New Life Assemblies of God in Centerville, Tennessee. So if you live near Dixon, Nashville, Centerville, that whole area, come out and join us. Now let's get into the Word. Turn with me, if you've got your Bible, to Luke chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. And Father, I just thank you for our audience today. Let the power of the Holy Spirit rest upon them as they hear the word. Let this word be spirit and life to them. Help us to grow in our faith and in our fellowship with you. Holy Spirit, you're welcome to fellowship with us through the word today and manifest yourself as this word goes forth in Jesus' name. Luke chapter 5, verse 1 says, "And as the multitude pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw by the lake a couple of boats, and he entered into one of the ships, being Simon's, and asked him to pull away from the land a little bit, and he sat down and taught the people from the ship." And I just want to stop right there. So Jesus here is preaching the word, a big crowd is pressed in, he's by the lake of Gennesaret, and this miracle we're going to talk about today, I connect with it. I don't know about you, but there are those certain Bible stories or scriptures I love to just gravitate back to because I had a connection with them for some reason. And I was thinking about my connection to this chapter and how I love the story, and it dawned on me the other day why I'm so connected. It's about good old down-to-earth country folks. I know we've got a lot of people watching from a lot of different areas, but I live in the country. I live on a dead-end road. The road dead-ends right into my driveway. Beautiful, peaceful setting. It's awesome. But not only were these country folks, see, when we hear the word Galileans, that's what Peter, James, and John were. They were Galileans. Jesus was from Nazareth, which was in Galilee. And we just think of somebody that lived in Galilee. But the Galileans had a certain reputation back in the day. They were the rednecks of their generation. I mean, if Jeff Foxworthy had been living there, then he would have done, "You might be a Galilean if." They were just good old down-to-earth country folks. But think about this for a minute. Regardless of your race, your background, where you come from, God's got something for all of us to do. And when it came time to change the world, did you notice that Jesus didn't go out and find the upper class of his day? He didn't go pick out the scribes and the Pharisees to follow him. He didn't go and find the best businessmen in Rome. You know who he picked? He picked a bunch of rednecks and changed the world with them. I mean, if Peter was alive today, he'd be driving around in a pickup truck with a hound dog and a toolbox on the back of it. It's awesome to think that no matter where you are in life, God created you for a reason. He's got a purpose and he's got something for you to do. But sometimes it's hard to see our purpose because we're right in the middle of the biggest trial of our lives. So Jesus comes here by the side of the Lake of Gennesaret. And I looked up that name Gennesaret in Hitchcock's Bible Names Dictionary and in Smith's Bible Dictionary. I thought it was interesting. It literally means the garden of the prince. So I thought about that a minute. You've got a place that means the garden of the prince. And who shows up? The Prince of Peace comes, and he's sowing the seed of the Word of God into people's hearts. Why? Because he wants to produce fruit. That's the reason we preach the Word. That's the reason we encourage people to study the Word and put the Word in your heart, because God's Word will produce fruit in your life. And here's the good thing. If you're planting a garden, what do? If you want potatoes, you go out and you plant potatoes. If you want corn, you go plant corn. If you want rutabagas, you plant rutabagas. You're getting the idea by this point. One year, my parents wanted strawberries here on their property. They planted a whole bunch of strawberry seed, and we had strawberries running out our ears so much it was hard to give them away by the end of the strawberry season. They were producing fruit. Well, here's the deal. If you need more peace in your life, maybe you're struggling with stress and worry, get some scriptures on peace and start planting peace in the garden of your heart. Find some scriptures on joy and just start planting joy in your heart. If you need freedom from a sin that you struggle with or a habit you're trying to break or whatever, take the scriptures like where Jesus said, "You shall know the truth and the truth shall make you free." Or, "If the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed." Or, "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be delivered." And just start meditating on the scriptures that pertain to your situation. Speak them, declare them, praise God for them like they've already come to pass in your life. And what are you doing? You're planting that like a seed in your heart, and it's going to bring forth fruit. Well, Peter, James, and John have been on this lake. You know, Jesus is here by the seashore, right there at the Garden of the Prince. And literally, that area was called the Lake of Gennesaret. Now, this same lake is also called the Sea of Galilee in some other passages. It's called the Sea of Tiberias in John chapter 21. It has several different names. But when it's called the Lake of Gennesaret, it's used pertaining to an area that's on the west bank of the lake. And it's like a horseshoe. It kind of curves around that bank. And the soil there is extremely fruitful. It's a very well-watered place. It's got several water sources coming down out of the mountains. And fruit grows really well there. And Jesus, as he's preaching, the crowds are pressing in. Why? Because they want to hear the word. And we'll get back to that in a minute. But the crowds have become so great, he's having trouble communicating with people. People can't hardly hear him or see him. So he sees these two boats sitting by the lake. And the fishermen have gone out of them, and they're cleaning their nets. Jesus gets into one of the boats that belongs to Simon and asks him, "Will you pull away from the shore a little bit?" And so Simon pulls away from the shore. Now you understand this wasn't necessarily convenient for Simon. It's been a long night. It's over. He's cleaning the net. And brother, not only was he a fisherman just going out fishing for pleasure, but these guys were commercial fishermen. We know that because after he gets his miracle here in a few verses, he signals to his partners, James and John. They weren't just out fishing for the pleasure of doing it. They were commercial fishermen. Now, even the guys that fish just for pleasure, I don't know about your neck of the woods, but around here we've got some committed fishermen. They don't quit until every bit of hope for them to catch a fish is gone. And it doesn't matter how bad it is, doesn't matter what the weather's like. They'll go fishing right in the middle of a storm. And nothing stops them. One time, Nikki and I had gone to visit a friend of ours that was in the emergency room. This is when my mom was still living. So we took her. We were calling on one of her church members. We got there, and around our neck of the woods, there's a lake. And there's a really popular bass tournament every spring. People come from all over the area to our little county, population, I think, 8,000 and whatever, for this bass tournament. And the grand prize is a brand new bass boat. Everybody wants to get it. Well, this guy came into the emergency room while we were sitting there, and it was the last day, as a matter of fact, of the big tournament. He came in there because he had a fishing hook stuck in his head and he couldn't get it out. And so the doctors and nurses, you know, were there. The nurse was giving him all the paperwork to fill out and asking him some questions. And she asked him, "Well, sir, how long has this hook been in your head?" He said, "Oh, I went to cast my hook out there and all that about 7 o'clock this morning. The wind blew and I threw it the wrong way and it accidentally got me in the head." She said, "Well, sir, why didn't you come in at 7 o'clock this morning when you first got the hook in your head?" He said, "Well, ma'am, I would have missed the bass tournament." Now, I think that's a little crazy, but that is commitment. These guys have been committed. They're going to make a living for their families. And this area of the Sea of Galilee was a big fisherman spot. There were some little fish there that kind of resemble what we would call sardines today. And they would pickle the sardines and sell them in the marketplace. And for your snack, you would have pickled sardines. You remember where Jesus turned the little boy's lunch into five loaves and two fishes into enough to feed the multitude. That's probably what these fish were. Now, brother, first of all, let me just say, it takes a redneck to turn pickled sardines into a lucrative business. That's all I'm going to say. But they're out here fishing. They're washing their nets. They're tired. And Jesus walks up to the ship and said, "Hey, Simon, let out a little bit from the shore for me if you don't mind." Peter pulls out there and Jesus sits there and he preaches a sermon and teaches the multitude from the ship. We don't know how long it lasts, but he's just going at it. I mean, there was one instance in Matthew 15 where people came out to the middle of the wilderness and they stayed with Jesus for 3 days just to hear him preach and watch him heal the sick and deliver the tormented. In Matthew 14, he had an all-day service where he had preached and taught all day long. He was definitely not a short-winded preacher, but the multitudes would stick with him. You know why? They were amazed by the word he spoke. And whenever you're like Simon, think about this a minute. They were in the middle of a fruitful, productive place, but they had had an unfruitful, unproductive long night. You ever been there? I mean, you go to church and you hear about who you are in Christ. In Christ, you're more than a conqueror. You can do all things through Christ, which strengthens you. You hear all about how in Christ you're a new creation and old things have passed away and all things have become new. Sometimes it would do a lot of folks good just to go through the New Testament and look up the phrases in Christ, in Him, in whom, and just see who we are and what we have in Christ. You hear all that, but then you leave the church and go back to daily life and you say, I'm supposed to be a fruitful, productive Christian, but I'm in a really unfruitful, unproductive long night. What do you need? First of all, you need the Word of God. And second of all, you need the power of the Holy Spirit at work in your life. See, Jesus' words weren't like everybody else's words. In Luke chapter 4, I believe it's around verse 36, the Bible talks about how the multitudes were amazed at Jesus because he spoke with authority and not like the scribes and Pharisees. Oh, the scribes and Pharisees had all the education, and I'm not against education. I have a doctorate degree. I've studied. I apply myself. Even to preach this broadcast, I went. I studied. I didn't just read a scripture and say, "Okay, Lord, fill my brain up with information." I looked stuff up. I looked up references and background and history and all that and studied for this. But here's the thing. When the Pharisees would get up and give their academic spiel in front of everybody in Jerusalem or at the synagogue or wherever they were, it was all a bunch of head knowledge. And head knowledge isn't where it's at, baby. You've got to have heart knowledge. You've got to have the Holy Spirit making that word come alive to you. And you've also got to have a word that comes out of your relationship with God. See, Jesus, unlike the Pharisees, had unlimited, unbroken fellowship with the Father. And he even told his people in the book of John, "I don't speak on my own authority. The Father in me does the works." So everything he said, yes, it was spirit and life, but it came out of his unbroken communication with the Father. Well, what about our words? The Apostle Paul was writing to the church at Corinth in 2 Corinthians. He was talking about his ministry credentials and how even though he was all educated and was a top student of the Pharisee Gamaliel and all that, it was nothing to brag about. But he talked about then how Christ had made them able ministers of the Spirit, not of the letter. Because the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. And so when we go to the Word, not only are we reading the Word, and I encourage people to get in the Word on a daily basis. Some people find it easy to like go through the Bible in a year. Some people, it's just a chapter a day. However you read, look, read and let the Holy Spirit communicate with you. The Apostle Paul wrote again in 2 Corinthians chapter 13 and said, "The love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all." Amen. That word communion means the presence of or fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The Holy Spirit wants to fellowship with you. One of the easiest ways to do it is to invite Him. Whenever you open the Word of God, just say, Holy Spirit, come fellowship with me today. Come guide me into all truth today. And you might see something kind of stand out to you. You might feel the urge to go look a word up in online in a Strong's Dictionary or Strong's Concordance. You might feel prompted to go study out a phrase in a commentary and see what it means. Whatever the Holy Spirit prompts you to do, He's trying to give you the answer to the problem you're facing. See, water in the Bible has a lot of different meanings, a lot of different symbolisms. Rivers of living water represent the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Springs can represent the presence of God. All kinds of things. But you know, in Genesis chapter 1, water is involved with chaos. The Bible tells us that in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And then verse 2 says, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved on the face of the waters. It was a chaotic time. There was no order in the universe. It was just a blob out here waiting for something to happen. We would say, it's all just chaos. It's all out of order. Sometimes people's lives feel like they're out of order. And you know what they need? They need a word to come to them under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was hovering over the face of the waters. And what was He waiting on? He was waiting on that word to bring it to pass. And all of a sudden the Father said, let there be light. And for 4 days before the sun, moon, and stars were ever created, there was supernatural light on this planet. Why? Because the Word and the Spirit came together. And that's what happened when Jesus would preach. That's why when He would preach, people got healed. People got delivered from demons. People who were tormented and broken were made whole. They would feel something. At one point, the Pharisees in John 7 sent a group of soldiers to arrest Jesus. And the soldiers came back empty-handed. And when the Pharisees asked them, what's wrong with you? We sent you to arrest Jesus. Why did you come back without Him? And the soldiers said, have you ever heard this guy? Why, never has a man spoken like this man speaks. They weren't used to the Word being spoken in the presence of the Holy Spirit. They were used to the Word being spoken and it being a rule book. They weren't used to somebody telling them how you can have an active, ongoing relationship with the Father right now. They were used to somebody taking the Word and saying, all right, here are the do's, here are the don'ts, baby. Now you take care of the do's and stay away from the don'ts and you'll be blessed. And if not, too bad for you. And if you had a problem in your life, they were taught that you were cursed because either you or your parents had violated the Word. And so here, Jesus comes on the scene. And He's preaching a word like they've never heard before because it's a word about the kingdom of heaven. It's a word about the King and His relationship to the people in the kingdom and how He wants to turn your life around and bless you and provide for you and how He wants you to live a higher life than what you've seen or thought possible. And while He's preaching this word, here's Simon, sitting in the boat. You know faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. Think about this a minute. It wasn't a convenient time for Simon. I hear people say all the time, well, Brother Jeremy, I just don't have time to get in the Word. I was counseling somebody not long ago, and I was talking to him about taking the Word of God and tearing down the strongholds that the enemy's built against you, and even renewing your mind with the Word of God. And one of the first things that I was told was, well, I just don't have the energy to go look up a bunch of scriptures and do that and whatever. And I'm thinking to myself, well, do you have the energy to stay in bondage for the rest of your life then? And I did take some scriptures and send to him and all that, because here's the bottom line is, if you want to be free, your freedom is going to come through what I call the dynamic duo, the Word of God and the power of the Holy Spirit working together in your life. And so Simon's sitting here in the ship. Jesus is teaching the multitude from the boat. Simon's hearing every word of it. No doubt his faith is coming alive. Now he knew who Jesus was at this point. Well, he had been there. Jesus had been to his house in Luke chapter 4 and healed his mother-in-law when she was really sick. He had watched Jesus at sundown that day on the Sabbath when the multitudes came to him and he healed the sick and cast out demons with a word. He knew how powerful Jesus was. So he was a believer in Jesus, but he wasn't a full-blown follower or disciple of Jesus at this point. We would call him a new convert. I mean, just learning who Jesus is and what he can do, but he hadn't got sold out just yet. But what if Simon had looked back at Jesus and said, "Don't you see I'm busy? I'm cleaning my net. I'm tired. I'm worn out. I just want to go have a steak and egg breakfast and go home and lay down and go to sleep until the next time to go fishing. Because in case you didn't notice, there ain't no fish in this boat. I'm about to go broke here if I don't catch something. My family could go hungry. I need to focus on business right now." You know what would have happened? He would have missed his miracle. And a lot of times, the cares of life, if we're not careful, especially when things aren't going real well, it takes our focus on what God's trying to do in our life and puts it in a different position. And instead of being focused on his plan and his purpose, we're focused on how frustrating things are. And no matter what somebody tries to tell us or do to encourage us, we just keep our minds on how rotten life is. But thank God, Simon had more sense than that. He knew this is a man of God. And if I honor God and if I honor the one that he sends, then I'll get blessed in return. You never loan your boat to Jesus without something happening for you. So he's right there. He's hearing the word as Jesus preached it. He, no doubt, he's feeling the presence and anointing of the Holy Spirit as Jesus is expounding the word. Then he wraps it up, dismisses the service, and says, "Hey, Simon, let down your nets. Go on out a little bit deeper than where you are right now and let down your nets for a big catch of fish." Well, see, a lot of times whenever we are in the middle of a crisis like Simon was, our temptation is we want to get out of the water. We just want to go lay down, go to sleep, and forget that the universe is even in existence. But God's saying, launch out a little deeper. Go get in the prayer closet and just rest in my presence a little bit. I got something to say to you. Just go study the word a little bit more. Go open your Bible to this book, this chapter, and I've got something I want to speak to you out of it. Maybe you'll feel a prompting to just put a worship song on and start praising God a little bit. I guarantee you it's not the enemy prompting you to worship God. And in the moment where you're tired and wore out, you're weary and well-doing, it's probably not your flesh wanting to hear a worship song either. So that is the Holy Spirit on the inside of you saying, draw near to God and he'll draw near to you, like it says in James chapter 4. Peter launched on out into the deep. It's time to launch out into the deep with God. It's time to launch out and start depending on him like we've never depended on him before. There's an outreach God gave Nikki the idea for back in 2011 called the Love Project. You'll hear more about it in future broadcasts. But every year we go into poor communities and take food, clothes, toys, and baby items and all that. And God has blessed it to the point that now it feeds thousands of people every year at the Christmas season. And God's done great things. And I like to be in that meet and greet room because, again, I love to connect with people. My job when everybody comes in is, first of all, to give them a little greeting, let them know what they can expect, and then make a beeline for the cross as quick as I can, tell them about God's love for them, tell them about Jesus, and give them a chance to get saved. And every year, people get saved. It's one of the biggest soul-winning events we have throughout the year. And every year, people will come up to me, and they'll give me their prayer request, and sometimes they'll be in tears, and I'll be in tears by the time they're finished. But to love them and to pray with them, it's awesome. When the Love Project first started, I liked having somebody with me because, thank God, my sight is still increasing. But I liked having somebody to lead me around the room and help me meet people and just shake hands with everybody. Well, this one particular year, I had my help lined up a few months in advance. I knew the guy that was coming. He had just accepted his call to the ministry. He was going to help me out, and I believe God was going to teach him some things and train him. But all of a sudden, at the last minute, some things happened, and he couldn't make it. And I'm out here just saying, "God, I don't have any help." You've got to show me what to do, Father. I need an assistant. I need somebody helping me. And right now, we need all the volunteers we can get in that area where people are getting the food and clothes and toys and being served. Send me some help, Lord. And I just heard the Holy Spirit on the inside of me say, hey, Jeremy, you've got me. How much more help do you need? I'm the helper. I'm the comforter. What was he saying? Hey, Jeremy, don't worry about how circumstances look. Just launch on out into the deep with me and I'll take care of it. So I went in there, just me and the Holy Spirit in that room. The crowd started together. I would share the gospel. I would do the best I can to maneuver around the room and meet some folks. And you know, throughout the day, either a pastor that had driven some of his people there to receive stuff, or some of the people that had come to be served themselves would walk up to me and say, hey, sir, do you need some help getting around the room? The Holy Spirit, who was my helper and is my helper, had people stationed exactly where I needed them. Why? Because I launched out into the deep. What if I had said, hey, Nikki, look, baby, I love you, but I can't do this because I don't have any help. I would have missed one of my favorite parts, like the highlight of my year, being able to connect with and minister to those people because I wouldn't have been willing to launch out into the deep. Not only did Jesus say, launch out into the deep, he said, Peter, give me an act of faith. Or Simon, let down your nets for a big catch. And Peter said, Lord, or Master, we've toiled all night and we've taken nothing. Now let me pause right there. Because the way I said that, I put emphasis on that toil and on that despair for a reason. Because I've got a King James Greek and Hebrew Key Study Bible by Dr. Zodiates here at the house. I love it, and it gives some really in-depth meaning of Greek words that were used. And when Peter said, we've toiled all night, there was a whole paragraph in that word toil. It means to work with perspiration, to work to the point of fatigue, to work even when you're frustrated. In other words, Peter was saying, Lord, look, I've had a tiring, frustrating, long night. I've sweated like a mule. We've done everything we could do. Now, you understand, as these guys were commercial fishermen, they knew where all the best spots on the lake were. They knew the best weather conditions to fish in. They knew when you were going to catch fish, when they were biting and when they weren't. And they've just had a fruitless night. These aren't just amateurs. They knew what they were doing, and they had literally exhausted everything they knew how to do. I can't tell you how many people have been in that boat that God has had us minister to, spiritually speaking. I mean, they'll tell me, brother, I've prayed, I've fasted, I've tithed, I've given offerings, I've confessed the word, and I just don't have anything to show for my labor. What do? You keep listening to Jesus, and when he prompts, you give him an act of faith. I'm not just talking about doing something crazy to try and prove to God you've got faith. I want that real clear. If you are believing God for a miracle, I am not telling you to go throw your medicine in the trash can to try to show God you've got faith. Honey, first of all, if your faith won't work while you're taking the pill, you're going to be in real trouble if you throw it in the trash can. What I tell people to do is you believe God for your healing. And even if symptoms are in your body right now, we pray, you believe that you receive your healing, and then you start launching out into the deep and drawing close to God by praising him for that healing or that financial blessing or whatever it is, just like it's already happened. And as you keep on standing in faith and praising God, symptoms are going to begin to subside. And there's going to come a point where you go back to your doctor and your doctor says you don't need this medication anymore. And then you start coming off the medication. But if God does it, he will confirm it by the doctor. You don't have to throw your medicine away to prove it. I'm emphasizing this because when I talk about giving God an act of faith, I've seen people do all kinds of crazy stuff. I know a man personally, and I'm not criticizing anybody, but he got a hold of just a little bit of teaching on sowing and reaping. I believe in that teaching. Nikki and I give even through the pandemic when we didn't have a place to preach and there wasn't a lot of money coming in. We kept on tithing and kept on sowing and giving and believing God. I believe in that. But this guy heard a little teaching and decided, I'm going to quit paying my mortgage and I'm going to sow that in an offering, and I'm going to just believe God to pay my house off. And for 2 or 3 or 4 months, however long it was, he quit paying his mortgage and gave what he would have paid his mortgage with in the offering plate. And do you know what happened? The bank didn't understand the principles of sowing and reaping, so they came and repossessed his house. It's a sad situation because he went around telling everybody, God showed me that all that prosperity stuff and all that sowing and reaping stuff doesn't work like they say it does. And I'm going, brother, let me help you out. God didn't tell you to quit paying your mortgage. And I've listened to faith preachers all my life and listened to preachers that believe in sowing and reaping all my life. And I've never heard them say, quit paying your mortgage. No, you gave an act of faith trying to prove something to God when he doesn't need any evidence. You pay your tithe. You give what the Holy Spirit leads you to give and then believe God to take care of your mortgage. But honey, he didn't lead you to quit paying your mortgage because there's too much in the Bible about paying what you owe somebody. And that's a nice little side note. But I just wanted to give that because Peter didn't just launch out there. And at this point, he's not really being called Peter a lot yet. We'll get there in a second. Right now, he's still being called Simon. Simon, that word in Greek means a reed, something that's unstable. A reed can be blown around with the wind. It's going this way one minute and this way the next. Just however the wind blows, that's how the reed's going. But he said, Lord, I've toiled all night, but nevertheless, at your word, I'll let down the net. Now notice, he didn't try to prove to Jesus that he had faith right in the middle of the message. He didn't throw his net out there while Jesus was preaching and go, oh, well, I'm here anyway. He's preaching the word. I'm in the presence of God. Let me just throw the net out and see what happens. No, he got a rhema word from Jesus, and when he got the instruction, he obeyed it, and things happened. Just like I said last week, a lot of times when you're believing God for a miracle, he'll give you an instruction. We talked about the wedding at Cana, how they had to go fill up the water pots. Well, there was another time that Jesus went into the synagogue. There was a man with a withered hand there, and Jesus looked at him and said, stretch out your hand. Well, the guy could have stood there and said, can't you see my hand's withered? I can't stretch out my hand. His hand was balled up, shriveled up, withered up. But when Jesus said, stretch out your hand, all of a sudden he started moving his fingers. He started stretching out that hand to the best of his capability. And when he started following that instruction and doing what he could do, you know what happened? As one brother would say, God put his super on that man's natural and he got the supernatural. He gave Jesus that step of faith and things happened. See, there was a time years ago when I was in my early 20s, I had just graduated from Bible college. And there had been a word spoken over me as a kid about a prophetic ministry. And I was standing and believing God for the gifts of the Spirit to start operating and prophetic ministry to come in my prayer lines. I'm laying hands on people, and just a couple of months in, I'd been laying hands on folks and praying in the Spirit, and God was giving me words for the people I was laying hands on. Thank God I'd been getting these testimonies about how the words were on target, and I was starting to get a little bit comfortable moving in the prophetic. And God decided it was time to launch out into the deep and throw my net out there. You know what I'm saying? He gave me an instruction that seemed ridiculous. I was preaching my first minister's conference in Virginia at the age of 22 years old. Just preaching away Thursday night of that conference, laying hands on the ministers, prophesying as the Holy Ghost led. This lady comes up and the Lord had me prophesy to her about her finances. I'm just telling her about the Lord will supply your need and just whatever the Lord put in my spirit, I gave to her. Well, then the prophetic word was over. And I just began to pray for her before I moved on down the line for her finances and believe God for that word to come to pass. Well, somebody said, well, Brother Jeremy, why did you do that? I mean, God spoke the word. Why don't you just believe him to let it come to pass? Well, we could ask Elijah that same question. After a 3.5-year drought, the Lord spoke to Elijah and said, it's time for rain in Israel. And if Elijah had been like a whole lot of church folks, you know what he would have done? He would have kicked back in his recliner with a bag of Doritos and a glass of sweet tea and said, oh, it's going to rain soon. After all, God said, it's time for the rain and God can't lie. So it's just going to rain soon. And 3 days later, he would have gone through a whole gallon of tea and probably two or three bags of Doritos in his recliner waiting for the rain to come, and the rain wouldn't have come. Why? Because a prophetic word is an invitation to your destiny. If I invite you over to my house to have a steak and you don't show up, you're going to miss the steak. And when you call me the next day, want to know why that invitation, that word didn't come to pass, I'm going to tell you, well, look, brother, I love you. I wish you had been here because I really would have enjoyed the fellowship. I did have a steak for you, just like I said. And if it's any consolation, your steak was delicious. But it's gone now. You missed the opportunity. That's what a prophetic word's like. No, Elijah went, confronted the prophets of Baal, prayed fire down from heaven, killed the prophets of Baal, climbed all the way up Mount Carmel, and prayed until his servant saw a cloud like a man's hand, and then said, let's get off this mountain and go back to the city, and I've got to tell Ahab not to let the rain stop him. He prayed his prophetic word in. So that's what I was doing with this lady. After the prophecy came forth, I started praying for her finances, just coming into agreement, helping her pray that word in. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me and said, hey, Jeremy, I didn't give you that word about her finances for you to pray. I gave you that word for you to take her an offering. I'm thinking, Lord, I'm in the middle of a prayer line. There are still other folk to lay hands on. And I don't normally take offerings for total strangers in the middle of a prayer line. But if that's what you're telling me, all I know is I obey the Holy Spirit. I'm going to go for it. And I took the risk and received the offering. The power of God hit that lady and she fell under the power. And while she was laying in the floor, people just started coming and laying money beside of her, just piling it up on the floor. Well, I found out the next day that God brought in a great catch of fish. She gave the testimony. She said, I've never had anybody do what that brother did last night. I'm thinking, I got news for you, sister. That brother's never done what he did last night either. She said, but I had been saving money to go on a missions trip. I believe it was Honduras that she was going to. And she said, I didn't have a lot of money. I was a little short. And then the Lord spoke to me to come to the conference. And so I took some of that money that I had been saving, and I was going to come pay for my hotel room. And when I got here, my hotel room cost more than I planned on. So I knew unless God provided, I wasn't going to get to go on the missions trip. But last night, as people were coming and just piling that money up beside of me, I got up and took the money back to my hotel. I counted it. And there was enough there to cover my hotel bill, send me on the missions trip, and I've got food to eat this weekend. Your spirit-led action makes a way for God to move. So Peter says, nevertheless, at your word, I'll let down the net. And when he let down the net, there was such a multitude of fish that the net started breaking. Do you realize, I love to tell people, and I kind of borrowed this from another evangelist I heard years ago, I serve El Shaddai, not El Cheapo. I serve a God who's more than enough. And I love what it says in Ephesians 3:20 in the New Living Translation, now all glory to God, who through the surpassing greatness of his power at work in us is able to accomplish infinitely more than we could ever think or imagine. And I love that because God's not out there saying, okay, I see you got this need. I'm going to do just enough to get you by till the next need comes along. No, if you'll believe him, he's got a net-breaking, boat-sinking load in mind for you. So much came in that Simon, soon to be called Peter, has to signal to his partners, James and John, and say, come join me over here. And they filled the boats up till both boats started sinking. See, I love the scripture in Philippians 4:19 where the Apostle Paul said, my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. But I don't like what religious people try to do with that verse. Because just like a lot of other promises in Scripture, men say it's too good to be true. And you know, Brother Jeremy, if it's too good to be true, it probably is. And so they'll try to water that verse down to fit our human experience. Let's quit watering down the word to fit our experience and believe God to elevate our experience to line up with what we see in his word. So people will do two things. I've heard people say, well, Brother Jeremy, you know that's talking about spiritual needs. That's not talking about material things. Well, that's interesting because the word need there in Greek, if you look it up, is a word that is specific to tangible material needs. It actually excludes spiritual needs. And then you've got other people that say, well, you know, that means God will supply your needs, but he may not necessarily give you your wants. And I've heard that all my life. So how is that word supply, if you look it up in Greek, doesn't mean to just give you enough to meet your needs. It means an overflow. Matter of fact, one of my favorite Greek scholars is a man named Rick Renner. He's a missionary to Russia and the Ukraine and all that area that we're hearing about in the news right now. He's got several churches there. He did a translation of Philippians 4:19 based on the definition of the word need and the word supply there. I just want to share that with you. And it goes like this. My God shall supply all your needs so completely that he eliminates all your deficiency. If you're looking to get out of debt right now, you maybe got some credit cards you're believing God to help you pay off. That's a good word to stand on. If God supplies your needs so completely that he eliminates all your deficiencies, that'll take care of your credit card debt. And then to go on, he says, he will supply all of your physical and tangible needs until you are filled and have no capacity to hold anything else. You know, that kind of sounds like what he says in Malachi chapter 3. When he says, bring all the tithe into the storehouse and I'll open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you won't have room to receive it. But then he doesn't stop there. Brother Rick goes on and says, it means that my God will supply all of your needs until you are totally filled, packed full, overflowing to the point of bursting at the seams and running over. Well, that's where they were. Their boats were so full, they were about to burst at the seams and run over and sink. Because God supplied all their needs. We don't serve a God who's in heaven just looking for an excuse to beat you over the head, beat you down, and try to make you live the lowest life possible. We serve a God who says, listen, if you'll obey me and hearken to my voice, I'll bless you in the city, bless you in the field, bless you coming in, bless you going out. I'll bless you in your basket, bless you in your store. I'll give you a surplus of prosperity. I'll bless the fruit of your womb. I'll bless your cattle. I don't have any cows, but I have a little Jack Russell Terrier that I claim that scripture for on a regular basis. I'll bless everything you set your hands to do. I'll open up my good treasure and give you the rain of your land in its season. Oh, by the way, don't worry about the enemy coming your way, because if he comes out against you one way, he'll have to flee seven ways. I'll sign up for that blessing. Thank you very much. That's the kind of generous God that I serve. But it takes something to receive that blessing. All God's promises are conditional. The promise there in Deuteronomy 28 was all about keeping the covenant. And thank God we're under a better covenant based on better promises than what the children of Israel had. These blessings belong to us in Christ. But in order to receive them, we've got to hear and respond to the word of God. See, in Luke chapter 6, verses 46 through 49, Jesus said, listen, I'm going to tell you something. He starts talking about two men. He said, the guy that hears my word and does it, he's like a man that went and built his house, and he built that house on a rock. And the rains came, and the winds beat against it, and the waves started crashing on it. But that house stood firm because it was built on the rock. But the man who hears my word and doesn't do it, that's like a man who builds his house on the sand. Now, I don't know about you. I love to go visit the beach and get in the sand. I love to just sit there in my chair, have my feet in the sand, hear the waves crash, maybe wade out in the ocean, find seashells in the sand. But I wouldn't want to build my house on the sand. Why? Because it ain't stable. And Jesus said, this guy builds his house on the sand. Well, maybe he thought, you know, I like the view here. That ocean looks good. I love those ocean breezes. I mean, I could just have my windows open during the summer and that breeze will keep the house cool. When I want to sleep at night, I can lay there and listen to the waves crash in my oceanfront bedroom and everything's going to be lovely. I'm just going to build my house right here on the sand. But then the rains came and the storms came and the waves started beating against it. And Jesus said that that house fell and great was the ruin of it. Now here's the lesson. Whether you hear God's word and do it or whether you hear God's word and don't do it, either way, storms will still come. I know that sometimes us faith preachers get accused of saying that if you've got faith in God, you'll never have a problem. Well, let me go on record. I've never said that, and I've never heard anybody else really preach that. The fact is that storms come your way. But if you build your life on the Word of God and on your relationship with Jesus, the rock, your house is going to stand firm and you'll still be standing when the day's over. But if you hear the Word and you don't follow it and don't obey it, oh, your house will crash. And sometimes God will give you advance warning that the storm's coming, sometimes not. I remember again when I was in Bible college, I was working in one church with my mom that she was pastoring. I was filling in at another church that was needing a pastor on Sundays and trying to minister to those folks. And thank God the church was growing and new people were coming, and people that had been out of church for years, even a decade or more, started coming back to that church as I was filling in there. I was enjoying a fruitful season. And I remember one night, I went to sleep and I had a dream. I dreamed that I was in a room watching the Weather Channel, looking at the map, and all of a sudden I saw a really bad looking storm. There was rotation in it. And I was looking as they were saying, there's a tornado coming, take cover. And then the scene switched and I saw the devil just like a serial killer going after somebody, wanting to take them out. And I knew that that somebody was me. I got up, I started praying, I started pleading the blood. I had another dream about a tornado coming. In that dream, I was pleading the blood. So you know what I was doing? I started saying, Lord, I plead the blood of Jesus and I forbid this problem to come. And that's not totally unscriptural. Sometimes you can be like Hezekiah and pray and God will turn things around. Other times the storm's going to come, but if you're in a relationship with Jesus, he'll get you through the storm. Well, the Bible calls Simon, Simon Peter, for the very first time in verse 8. He said that Simon Peter, when he saw it, fell down at Jesus' knees and said, depart from me, for I'm a sinful man, O Lord. And Jesus said, don't be afraid. From now on, you'll catch men. This is the first time in this narrative that he's called Simon Peter instead of Simon. As I said earlier, Simon means a reed, something unstable. Peter means a rock, something stable. You know what's going on? Peter's transformation from the reed to the rock has begun. Now he's feeling like, oh, I'm a sinner. I've blown it. But no, Peter, listen, yeah, we're all sinners. We've all come short of the glory of God. Now, if you're born again, you're not a sinner anymore. But Peter's transformation has begun from the reed to the rock. See, we're all a work in progress. You may not be who you're going to be yet, but thank God you're not who you used to be anymore. And Jesus tells him, don't be afraid. From now on, you'll catch me. See, God's got no desire to depart from you. God looked down through time and eternity and saw the gap that was created between us because of our sin, and he came in the person of Jesus Christ to bridge the gap and bring us back to him. And I love that word to catch, and I know I'm running out of time, so I'm about to wrap this up. But the word translated catch, when he says you will catch men, in the Old Testament Greek translation called the Septuagint, that same Greek word for catch is used in the context of rescuing men and women from the peril of death. So he's saying, hey, Peter, listen, you've seen a great catch today, but don't be afraid and don't worry about your past, Peter. It's time to walk out of the past and into the future that I've got for you, and you're going to rescue people from the very peril of death itself and cause them to come into the kingdom. And the Bible said that when they got their boats to the shore, they left everything and followed Jesus. Now, thank God in Mark chapter 10, later on, Jesus tells them, listen, if you've left anything, houses, lands, mothers, fathers, children, whatever you've left for my sake, you will receive 100-fold here in this life and in the life to come, everlasting life. They left everything to follow Jesus. But they found out that the cost was well worth it, because when they left everything to follow Jesus, they became world changers. There are people I witness to that say, I don't know if I want to give up this sinful life I'm living and follow Jesus. But honey, understand something. If God wants you to give something up or leave something behind to follow him, he's not trying to take something from you. He's trying to get a blessing to you that you never could have had on your own. So if you've never started following Jesus, it's real easy. Just pray this after me. Just say, Lord Jesus, I want to be your follower. I know that I'm a sinner, that I'm not perfect, but I believe you died on the cross for me. I believe you rose from the dead. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus, and be the Lord of my life. Change me. Help me to follow you. Guide me to be everything you want me to be. In Jesus' name, amen. And if you just prayed that prayer, welcome to the family. Go find a good Bible-believing church to get into and fellowship with God's people. And get strong in your relationship with the Lord. And Father, I thank you for those that are watching this broadcast right now. That maybe they're struggling with a time of frustration. Maybe like the disciples in Luke 5, they had a fruitless, unproductive night. But I thank you for the seed they've been sowing as they've been praying, declaring your word, perhaps fasting, as they've been tithing and giving and being obedient to your voice. And I thank you that you said, let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we'll reap if we faint not. So today I ask that the Holy Spirit would minister comfort to them. I bind every spirit of infirmity and I loose the healing power of God to flow from the top of their head to the soles of their feet and make them whole. And I'll give you all the glory for what you do in their lives in Jesus' name. Amen. If this broadcast has been a blessing to you, do us a favor. Reach out and let us know it. We'd love to hear what God is doing in your life through this broadcast. Thank you so much for watching. Join us next week, same time, same station. God bless. We'll be right back.
Join Winning in Prayer TV Christian Broadcasting on Roku. Your ministry will be shared on social media platforms, streamed on Roku with the reach of 55 million homes. It will be your choice of day and time, professional editing, and a low weekly cost of $25 a week. Contact us today at 941-782-8322, or you can email at winninginprayertv@gmail.com. Again, contact us at 941-782-8322, winninginprayertv@gmail.com to get more information. Thank you and hope to hear from you soon.
An employment issue. Father God, we do thank you for those that may be facing an employment issue. Father, your word declares that the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord as the rivers of water, and you turneth it whithersoever you will. So God, we just thank you for those who are in power. We thank you for favor with those that are in power, that they will look favorably upon us, God. And so we just thank you for victory in all circumstances, all situations. God, we thank you for reports of not only one job offer, God, but we thank you in advance for multiple job offers, God, with good pay and good benefits, God. And so, God, we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise right now. In Jesus' name we pray and we thank you. Amen.